Anyway, Tom looks like a pretty good guy here, so we talked and chatting just a little bit before. And say something good, I don't know. Let's see.
I was asking a lot, I know.
Okay, what would you like me to say about you? Just had a few misdemeanors in your past?
Yeah, that's it. My mom still likes me, that's nice.
Your mom likes you, yeah. That's good. Okay, there's a person whose mother really loves him. Tom Irwin, let's give him a big Globe Theater hand.
There's introductions and then there's introductions. That was beautiful.
That was one of them.
Yeah, one of them. I mean, record that and we'll just play it at every show from now on. I ever do. Well, pleasure to be back here again. I think I'll start off with since I said my mother loves me, I'll start off with a song I wrote about my father. His name was Arthur Clyde Irwin Jr. You know, he came from the old school, grew up on the farm. I don't know if the generation of people that pick up sticks out there and told they had to go pick up sticks. Yes, it's a lost art, I believe. I don't even know if they even have sticks anymore sometimes. It's hard to tell. Anyway, Dad had a lot of funny sayings. I got a bunch of them in here. And several of them I couldn't put in and sing in front of a public either. So, one of those guys. I think the one I left out, but I'll share it with you because it's like a very adult crowd. Stop you running around, you hack like a fart in a skillet. What does that mean? I don't know. So I left that one out, but I just had to let you share that one. So here's one about my dear old dad. Well, he liked to drink, but I never saw him drunk. Did not care to kill, but he sure enjoyed a hunt. He called horses hay burners and dressed in a cowboy way. And come hell or high water, he'd ride his Harley to church Sundays. Now you go pick up sticks, you got nothing better to do. Get off the couch, get outside, get that stink bone off of you. And if your brains were dynamite, boy, you could not blow your nose. And that's how he said, I love you, by keeping us on our toes. He adored his mom and called his wife mother. Brother, there ain't no bad pie, there's just some better than others. Sought out the good, avoided the bad. You called him Clyde, and I called him Dad. Well, he liked to listen to the whistle of a train. And he always seemed to know the measure of a recent rain. Favorite pastime, it was to sit and talk. Yeah, and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk and talk. He was proud, yeah, to be one of the few. We would often disagree, but he'd back me in what I'd do. Everybody got a nickname, not always complimentary. He let God take care of him as he cared for his family. He adored his mom and called his wife mother. Brother, there ain't no bad pie, but just some better than others. He sought out the good, avoided the bad. I called him Clyde, and I called him Dad. You called him Clyde, yes, I called him Dad. Sound familiar there? All right, so I grew up on the farm, mom and dad, my brothers and sisters lived on one side of the big old farmhouse, and my grandma lived on the other, so it was my dad's father-in-law, so I always feel like if I do his song, I should do her song too, so. They got along pretty good, but you know, it was a mother-in-law, and she owned the farm, and so dad always had to kind of do things, whatever he had to do to keep it going, but grandma and I were really close friends. She was, like say, in the house with us, the same house, just on the other side. Just wear those old black shoes, you know. Wear a dress out to go work in the garden, you know. One of the grand old ladies. Her name was Ruth Duncan. One thing I say about songwriting, you know, I'm kind of lucky. It kind of helps to get through grief and different things in life, and this song is helping me get through the loss of old dear old grandma. So most of my songs are either about the farm or something happened there. Get to a few more of those later. Now my grandma, I said we kind of spent the house, stayed in the house with her, lived right next door, all that. So I heard a lot of stories kind of shaped my life. Actually, she was born in the house. It's kind of an interesting fact that happened a lot these days in 1895. And was hardly sick a day in her life. Was in the hospital the last maybe week or so before she passed away and got her home. So died in the house where she was born. Kind of interesting. But she's telling me these tales of family members that I, of course, would never know. They were long past by the time I was around. But this favorite guy that she used to talk about, his name was Uncle Fudd. F-U-D, one D. Before Elmer was around, you know, and got fancy and put the two D's on the end of the Fudd name. But being a Fudd was kind of, you know, being a joker, ne'er-do-well. You were a Fudd. There's an old old fiddle song called Uncle Fudd, and I believe he's also mentioned in Tennessee Stud, if you know that song. A line about Uncle Fudd, but long before that, this was guy's name was James Taylor Duncan, and Grandma said when he passed away, it was her first great sorrow. So he lived in the mid-1800s and died in the early 1900s. All the rest of the brothers and sisters out of the 13 in the family were did quite well for themselves. They were farmers and pharmacists and real estate guys. Even the women who back then, you know, didn't usually do careers, but both Aunt Nellie and Aunt Marthy were involved in teaching and over in Petersburg. So everybody did well except for Uncle Fudd. He drank a lot, they said. Drank whiskey kayak quite well and played the fiddle rather poorly, I think the family story went. We still got his fiddle at home, so I think he enjoyed playing it himself. So here's the story of my great Uncle Fudd. In an unmarked grave on Family Road, upon a lonesome hill, lies a long forgotten man no one ever will remember. He lived in his brother's one-room shack over in Salisbury. He kept his fiddle in an old flour sack, and once he almost got married in September. Said he drank too much. Fudd said he did not drink enough. He said that he was lazy. He just told them all they were crazy. And I say, here lies Uncle Fudd. Here lies Uncle Fudd. Here lies my great Uncle Fudd. West of Colorado, he was 18 and 85. He got in a scrape down in Pueblo, barely made it back here alive, but he did. When he hopped off the train, he was glad to see that no one was waiting there. But how ashamed would the family be to know he paid no fare? But he brought some presents. When Billy Murray had sat on his knee, he'd tell him tales of the West. Virginia Ruth and Angie Marie, they thought he was the best uncle they had. Old Fudd couldn't see past the end of his nose. He never bothered with that. The kids would find him standing in the cornrows, not knowing where he was at, but he was never sad. They said he drank too much, but said he did not drink enough. They said that he was lazy. They just told them all they were crazy. And I say, here lies Uncle Fudd. Here lies Uncle Fudd. Here lies my great Uncle Fudd. Suddenly, Fudd took sick over in Salisbury. And Aunt Marthy said, hey, Fudd, what's this trick? And he died on the way to Atterbury with no more beer. No more beer, not for Uncle Fudd. Like a little man, Billy Murray never cried. Ruth and Ann, she did. When the Petersburg Undertaker came driving by, everyone ran and hid and shed their own tears. Yeah, for Uncle Fudd. And they said he drank too much. Fudd said he did not drink enough. They said that he was lazy. He just told them all. say, here lies Uncle Thud. Here lies Uncle Thud. Here lies Uncle Thud. No more beer. No more beer. Oh, there's no more beer. Not for Uncle Thud. This thing does. I'm here to terrorize you with my harmonica. I'm going to do a few songs now from a project I'm working on now called the Sangamon Songs. I did a recorded with the Gordons. I'm sure you're familiar with them. I started working on this around 2008 and recorded with Gary in 2011, put it out in 2012 as a record, and then a few years back. Sooner than that, but last fall, a friend of mine was visiting town, and he really liked the record, and he always wanted to write a play, so he connected all the songs are already connected, and he kind of wrote a script to it, and we've been putting this whole show on, called the Sangamon Songs, a musical play. Won't be able to do that today, but I'll sing some of the songs from it. It all stemmed from, they say a lot of stuff I write about came from me as this old farmhouse. The family that lived before us, before the Duncans, my maternal great-grandfather bought the house. There was a family there called the Ludlums, and a 16-year-old boy named Harry Glenn Ludlum lived in this house from his age of about 5 years old until he was 16, 17. And the last year he was there, from August until February, he wrote a diary. He wrote it every day. He wrote about a lot of, mostly about the weather and about shucking corn. And Uncle Ed going to town in the buggy. But in the midst of all those kind of mundane things, he also went to the World's Fair in Chicago, 1893, the World's Columbian Exposition. He talked about gypsies that camped out down by the creek. His grandmother passed away in January, and he wrote about that, some beautiful thoughts. And then the family sold the farm, and my great-grandfather bought it, and he left his diary there, and I found it 110 years later. So. Seriously, sticking in an old cabinet. So I wrote all these songs kind of based on that. It's the quick story of it. This one is an audience participation song just to keep you awake. One day in his entry, a few folks probably worked on farms or know people that have, the work's kind of never done. But one day on his journal, he wrote about shucking corn. Uncle Ed went to town. Ma and Grandma took the buggy and went over to the farm in the little town, and then he says, the rest of the day, I'm doing nothing. So, I thought there should be a song about doing nothing. The audience participation part, your job is to say nothing. Cold or be it hot, for me it matters not. The one thing worth remembering is not to do a lot. You can let it rain or let it shine, either way I'm doing fine. Not to let myself forget that the easy road is mine. And today I'm doing nothing. Yeah, tomorrow I'm doing nothing. Yes, I finally found a way just to lay around all day. Doing
nothing.
If you will, but Buster, You just wait until I complete my nothing feat. In a bit I've had my fill. You might think I'm stupid or think I'm dumb, but I think you know where I'm coming from. I wasn't born to just shuck corn, rest station, here I come. And today, I'm doing it. And tomorrow, guess what? I'm doing it. Yes, I finally found a way just to lay around all day. Get ready for it. Doing
nothing.
There you are. All right. We love it all. Just always remember, folks, I've been working on this a long time. You think I get this right? When you're doing nothing, you're actually still doing something, right? It's good to remember that the something you're doing when you're doing nothing is usually more important than the something you're doing when you're trying to do something. Yeah. Did that make sense?
Not sure. I got to think about it.
Yeah, think about it. Yeah, that is. That, like, that's a good idea. Everybody's always trying to do something. All right, I think I will do... It's one of my favorite songs off the record. I might pick up Greenville. Oh, gee, there it is. I was always surprised. I mean, doing this diary thing was such a beautiful revelation for me. You know, I just kind of was as surprised as anyone when I turned a page. I took it to the local library and we had copies of it made because it was kind of like the Dead Sea Scrolls. You know, every time you picked one up, pieces of it were falling apart. But I was really surprised to see that we're reading through the entry. He's like, yeah, we're leaving tomorrow on the train. We get to go to the World's Fair. You know, if you know anything about the fair, if you read that book, Devil in the White City or anything, it was a pretty incredible thing. It's up in the south side of Chicago. About a quarter of the population of the United States saw it. Speaking of these beautiful lights here, that was like the first time most people saw electric lights. If you can imagine, let's see what else. Wrigley's gum was introduced there. Quaker Oats, Aunt Jemima, Hershey's chocolate bars, all these things, Cracker Jacks, things we kind of take for granted today. The very first dishwasher was supposed to be there. Maybe they'll show the movie The Current War in here, but that was about Tesla and Edison, which that was the big battle they had at the World's Fair. And fortunately for all of us, Tesla won. And they used his alternating current system. But the two biggest things about the fair were this girl, a young woman named Little Egypt, right? I maybe have heard of her. She was a dancer, belly dancer. Also, the first time America had ever seen belly dancing in combination with beer drinking. And she danced there at the fair. She was a sensation in a place called the streets of Cairo. Not Cairo. Say streets of Cairo because I kept wanting to say Cairo. The other big sensation of the fair was the Ferris wheel. It was invented by a guy named George Washington Ferris Jr. out of Pittsburgh. He was born up in Galesburg, actually. And he invented this Ferris wheel, right? You all know what a Ferris wheel is, but this one, I don't know if you realize, was like 26 stories tall. Just incredible, you know. 2,000 something people at times could ride on it. The cars weren't, you know, the little three-seaters that we know of, but the cars were the size of railroad cars. It's incredible. It cost 50 cents to ride it. Paid for the whole fare and just an amazing thing. So that was the cool thing about reading the diary. Harry wrote one day before he went, he said, hurrah for the World's Fair, and he drew a little picture of his Ferris wheel. So I figured he was excited, so that's the name of his song. Join me, if you will, let's take a little trip up to the World's Fair in Chicago in 1893. This is right, about 5 days before the fair closed in the end of October. Well, Mom and Grandma are leaving on the morning train. And me and Paul and Uncle Ed, tomorrow we'll do the same. Riding on the CNA to where I never dreamed I'd go. Hurrah for the World's Fair up in Chicago. It was the world's Columbian exposition. created by an act of Congress in commemoration of the coming of Columbus, 1492, to a world so full of promise, we can only call it new. Hurrah! Chicago's great World's Fair. At the sight of the white city, Grandma broke down and cried, overcome by its splendor, succumbing to her sense of pride. Paul and Uncle Ed went to the streets in Cairo, but Ma said that was no place for a decent boy to go. But I did not come to see Little Egypt do a hoochie coochie dance. No, I came to the fair for one thing, and I dare not miss my chance. There on the Midway Placement sat that colossal of American steel, and I paid my 50 cents to ride George Ferris's great wheel. Hurrah! Hurrah! Nothing made my man on God's earth could come there. Hurrah! Hurrah! Hurrah for Chicago's great World's Fair. Chicago, it was ranked, yes, and rotten to the core, but 7 miles from downtown on that Lake Michigan shore, rose a modern miracle from the swamps of Jackson Park. It was a brief beacon of beauty in a world both bleak and dark. Hurrah, hurrah. Nothing made by man on God's earth could come there. Hurrah, hurrah, hurrah for Chicago's great World's Fair. Step right up and get your Cracker Jacks. I don't think I mentioned that's where Pabst Blue Ribbon got its blue ribbon. Hoochie coochie dance, I'm not kidding, really did go just like this. Recognize that? There we are. All right. I also mentioned that Harry wrote in his diary. This is probably the one, actually, Roberta Gordon, if you guys know, I shared the story, because Roberta's just great. She was helping me going through, because there were hundreds of pages, you know, so it was kind of like reading the congressional report or something. But we would just sit down and kind of go through them, and one day, and of course, I love Roberta's got that, you know, just such a inspirational person, but she came running over the other side of the room, I found some, Tom, I found some. And at the end of this regular journal entry, he says, there's a lot of gypsies camped down by the creek. One of their dogs got into our sheep and I'd have shot it, but my rifle missed fire. I'm thinking, wow, you know. So I went upstairs and looked out the window down to the creek, which is about a couple hundred yards from the house, and tried to imagine what it was like for this 16-year-old boy looking outside and seeing all these strange people down there. And they weren't like the gypsies we know, we would think of the Romanies from Eastern Europe. They were actually people from Southern Indiana. Indianapolis, and they were called the Ishmaelites, and we found historical records. They traveled up like the Kankakee and then down through Decatur and around the country through here. They think maybe like the town of Mahomet, which is a, you know, rather odd name for this part of the country, was named for, by these people. So they were called the gypsies just because they traveled through, but they were a strange bunch, you know. My grandma would tell me stories about how they'd camp down there, but then they'd come up and beg for money, and grandma would always, her mother would give them money. Sometimes if you didn't, your barn might accidentally catch on fire. Indiana didn't like them so much that they passed the first eugenics law ever in the United States of America in 1907 to try and get rid of these people and have them be sterilized so they wouldn't be able to continue to live, have other kids. Anyway, that law was on the Indiana books until like 1974. By that time, they'd sterilized around 2,500 of these Ishmaelites. But here's the idea of what I'm thinking. Harry looking out the window, being a good Presbyterian boy, trying to figure out what in the world are these people doing in this, out there. So this is called When the Gypsies Camped on Prairie Creek. To the west from my bed upstairs, I see their campfires flickering. I smell burning meat and the kerosene. I hear the songs and their fiddling. Wonder why they keep on living like wild creatures in the field. To me they have no earthly purpose. God's plan is yet to be revealed. But oh, I try to love them too, like my maker would have me do. But they're freaks. We are strong and they are weak. And I felt no pity when the gypsies camped on Prairie Creek. Day a gypsy girl with sticks for crutches and bandages came begging at our door. Ma gave her 3 whole pennies. She took them and asked for more. Ma shook her head and shrugged her shoulders as the gypsy girl let out an awful curse. Threw down her crutches and bandages and left with those pennies in her purse. And oh, I tried to love her too, like my maker would have me do. But they're freaks. We are strong and they are weak. And I felt no pity when the gypsies camped on Prairie Creek. Right around supper, this very evening, I heard the livestock getting riled. I reached for my rifle in the corner, grabbed my hat, some bullets, and I smiled. Down the barn, out in the pasture, in the sheep, just past the hogs. When I shot my rifle, it missed fire. I did not get to kill that gypsy dog. But oh, I tried to love it too, like my maker would have me do. But they're freaks. We are strong and they are weak, and I felt no pity when the gypsies camped on Prairie Creek. All right, it's getting a little serious for me. So, here's one of the fun things about the journal. I'll do one, a few more songs here, and we'll get Mark up. One day I was reading through the journal, like I said, trying to figure out songs to write about it. And Harry says, the neighbor on the next hill over on the next house, his name was Julius Tuxhorn. He says, Julius Tuxhorn is having a barn dance. Me and Ben are going to go over to it, but what we, and he talks about the next day, he said, but what we did last night, we will never tell. So, yeah. So I'm thinking too, right, this is your diary, dude, you know, come on, you're supposed to write something, but did not say it. So I thought about writing a song about it. I thought, well, I won't tell his secret anyway, but we'll make that the fun part, right? Julius Tuxhorn is having a barn dance. I get to wear my new $2 pants from across the road, cause my best buddy Ben, we told the folks we'd be back, but we did not say when. Well, we crossed Prairie Creek and climbed up Tuxhorn's Hill, looking for some fun and hoping for a thrill. I might kiss Pollyanna or take a sip of shine. What goes on behind the barn ain't no one's news but mine. What went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? Or what went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? Tell them about it. Well, the secret ain't a secret once it's been let out. It's keeping secret, secrets, what a secret's all about. You can ask me or Ben, we might tell you the truth. If we do or don't, friend, you never have no proof. But what went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? What went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? Tell about Jim. You can ask me anything that comes to your mind. The questions are easy, the answers hard to find. Yesterday, tomorrow, forever, or a day. You can ask me anytime, but I will never say. Oh, what went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? What went on last night? What went on last night? I will never tell. What went on last night? I won't eat. Remember, I always feel like I got. Remember the old Warner Brothers cartoons? The guy would say, "And I won't either." Anyway, that's always. So I did a recording, a new album up in Chicago. Got to record it with a guy named John Sturrett. He's in the band Wilco. I got to see them Thursday night down at the Fox. It was a really great show. He was a really great guy. I mean, sometimes you get lucky, right? You know, he's their Grammy Award-winning band and all that good stuff. And we happened to be playing at the same place. He was in a different band at that time. And it just, while they're waiting for Wilco. Anyway, we became friends and he liked my songs. And he asked if he could produce the record. And he did. And he played on it. He's like, I got this drummer. You mind if he come plays on it? I'm like, well, I don't know. Who is it? They go, it's Gee Whiz, they call him. He plays with Norah Jones. He's really good. I'm like, Norah Jones? Okay. So we had different people like that that came and played, so very proud of it. And this is the title track on it. Wrote this song, I think I can say this, I wrote this song under the influence of drugs. It was all that prednisone, stuff. Stayed up all night, but I thought that was a pretty good thing. I wrote a song called All That Love while I was doing prednisone, so. You know that. That's an accomplishment if you know that stuff, right? Well, you may try my patience then, but I will try again and again. Grab hold of all that love. No one may follow me, but everyone can surely see what it is I'm speaking of.
There in you and me, blow
worth a try anyway, right? I think, well, how are we doing on time? I didn't pay attention. About one more, is that about right?
You think? Yeah, that'd be good.
That'd be good?
Yeah.
That's good. I hate it when they say, how about one more, be about right? It's like, no, that's enough. That's good. Thank you. That's never happened before. You know, Mark's got plenty of stories too. But his book is fantastic. I love it. It's like, it's really special when you're out playing all the time too, and you're going to go, oh yeah. We were talking about some of that stuff. And like the time you're playing in a bar and a guy comes up and is like, man, I'll give you $50 if you just go home. Come on, play the jukebox and hang out. They're like, well, I guess. I get $20 anyway, right? So sometimes you just got to cut your losses and go. But most of the time, I'm sure Mark will agree, it's a very fulfilling and wonderful thing to be able to get out and play for people and hope you get something out of it. As I said, there's kind of, part of playing music too is being part of people's lives, you know, really getting into it. And this is a song I wrote for my friend Ben Bedford, who's a wonderful songwriter. He's got back from a nice tour of Europe and doing really good. When they got married, they said, hey, would you write us a song? You're like, sure. And you think, oh man, gotta write a song for somebody's wedding. So I came up with this one, and the kind of nice thing about it is him and his wife were kind of, you know, he was gone a lot, so they went through some slow times, shall we say. But they're back together, and so now I can keep singing this song because the name of the song is called Love Forever Wherever You Go. So if they'd have divorced, I'd been, I don't know what I'd done. But anyway, they're back together, it's a happy story, and I thank you for listening today, and we'll have Mark up next. This one's called Love Forever Wherever You Go. There's a little sing-along at the end if you care to join in. Sweet little thing on the side of the road, wearing a smile, carrying everybody's load. Her eyes are sparkling cause she knows what? She's got love forever wherever she goes. A long-legged fella in the back of the room, bringing a grin, singing a lonesome tune. His music shining cause he knows what? He's got love forever wherever he goes. Love forever. Is it love forever? Yeah, from high on the mountain to the valley below, love forever wherever we go. Finding love is easy, they say, but it's oh so hard to get it to stay. You know love will do its part if you let it into your heart. Hey, a long-legged fella and a sweet little thing, and had it found a song and they're bound to sing. Why, sure, together, don't you know, but yeah, they got love forever, forever they go. Love forever. It's love forever. Yeah, from high on the mountain. Forever, it's love forever. From the high on the mountain to the valley below, love forever wherever you go. If you want to sing your part with me, love forever wherever you go. I'll say a whole bunch of stupid stuff, but don't stop. Whenever I say something stupid, then you go, love forever wherever you go. And it'll help me get through this. New York City to San Francisco.
Love forever.
Los Angeles to Chicago,
love forever wherever you go.
London, Moscow, Tokyo,
love forever wherever you go.
Rio de Janeiro,
love forever wherever you go.
Istanbul to Orlando,
love forever wherever you go.
Holy Toledo,
love forever wherever you go.
Warm draft beer to fine Merlot,
love forever wherever you go.
A bologna sandwich to escargot,
love forever wherever you go.
All the hair on your head, your dirt on your toes,
love forever wherever you go.
Love forever, love forever wherever you go. Love forever, yeah, love forever wherever you go.
Thank you.
a bus and take it with us. So, all right, thank you very much.